Now let's look at a slightly more involved problem from your textbook. This is example 5.9. Okay, so in this example, we have a car and we have a truck. And these two are on a horizontal surface. Okay, we'll call this A, we'll call this B. And the question is, a truck A collides with a parked car B, so B is at rest. Assuming that the friction between A and B and between B and the ground is negligible, so there's no friction anywhere, compare the post-impact velocities. If A, the pavement is compliant, that means it responds non-impulsively, and B, the pavement is rigid, which means it responds impulsively. So A has a pre-impact velocity, let's say VA minus, and impact happens, you know, let's say at this point, that's the point of impact. So which means that the tangent direction, this is the tangent direction, let's say, and then this is the line of impact. Okay, that's line of impact, right? And this angle from horizontal between line of impact and horizontal direction is alpha, right? So we know this angle is alpha. So this is tangent direction, this is the normal direction. We can assume this to be positive E n hat, this to be positive E t hat, okay? So the two cases are, one, that pavement is compliant, and the case B is pavement is rigid. So what's the difference between the two scenarios? So in the case A, when it says the pavement is compliant, that means that after the impact, the car can actually go inward, can go downward into the pavement, right? So you can actually model this whole pavement as a platform which is mounted on a spring, right? So the case A, you know, could be that this whole pavement over here is replaced by a platform mounted on springs. It could be one spring, three springs, doesn't matter. Okay, and the car, when it is pushed downward, pushes this plate in the downward direction, and that means that the normal reaction between the pavement and the car cannot be an impulsive force, because impulsive forces can, you know, rise in magnitude as much as possible to maintain the constraints of the system. In this case, there is no constraint. The car can move downward. That means that the force from the pavement on the car cannot grow arbitrarily large, right? Because we know elastic forces are finite in magnitude. So that's number one thing to notice from this problem. On the other hand, in the case B, when the pavement is considered to be rigid, that means to maintain the constraint of the system, which means that the car really cannot go inside or downward direction, the reaction forces from the ground on the car at the time of impact would have to be very, very large, because they can grow arbitrarily large in magnitude, right? So that kind of force would be an impulsive force. So in case A, when the pavement is compliant, or the car doesn't face any impulsive force from the ground, but the car can go in the downward direction, which means that it will have some component of velocity in the downward direction. So we'll show the downward direction as maybe Y. So we'll say this is, let's say, positive X direction, and that's positive Y direction. So you can see that we have kind of two coordinate systems over here. One is a tangent normal coordinate system, other is the XY. You know, tangent normal, I'm just saying because we have a tangent and normal direction well defined, I could call it X prime, Y prime as well, okay? So in the case A, the car can move downward. In the case B, the car cannot move downward. That means that after the impact, we know definitely that the velocity of the car along Y direction would be zero, which is not the case when the pavement is compliant, right? Okay, so let's look at the case A first. So case A is compliant pavement. So how do we solve the problem? We'll start by drawing the free body diagram at the point of impact. So, you know, here is our particle B, here is our particle A, right? And that's our tangent direction, that's our normal direction, okay? So what are the impulsive forces on the system? So we're drawing the free body diagram of the system, A and B together. So on A and B together, well, there are no other impulsive forces, right? Because the reaction force on B from the ground is going to be non-impulsive. The reaction force on A is going to be non-impulsive too, because the effect of hitting the car by the truck would enable the truck to actually go up, right? Because it's acting at an angle alpha from horizontal. So which means that there are no external impulsive forces on the system. On the other hand, if you draw a free body diagram of B alone, on B, there is an impulsive force from A, so let's call it R, right? That's A, that's B. And then on A, we have the same impulsive force R from B, okay? So that's the tangent direction, and this is the normal direction, right? Okay, so which means that you will not be able to conserve linear momentum of B before and after the impact along normal direction, but there is no impulsive force along tangential direction, so you can definitely conserve that, right? Okay, so let's write all these equations for conservation of momentum. So for B, we have MA VB along tangential direction plus MA VA and then MB VB minus along tangential direction. B is the stationary before the impact, so this is actually 0 equal to MA VA plus along tangential direction plus MB VB plus along tangential direction. Okay. And that's just along the tangential direction. We can also write this along the normal direction, right? So we have MA VA minus N plus MB VB minus along normal direction, MA VA plus along normal direction plus MB VB plus along normal direction. Okay. So again, we know that VB minus is 0, so VB minus N would be 0. Okay, so this is something we can write for the system. So we're conserving linear momentum along both tangent and normal direction because as far as the system is concerned, there are no external forces acting on the system. Then for B alone, we can conserve linear momentum along tangential direction. So that would be MB VB minus along tangential direction, which is 0, equal to MB VB plus along tangential direction. Okay, same thing for the A. We get MA VA minus along tangential direction equal to MA VA plus along tangential direction. Now, we know the velocity of A before the impact that is given to you as VA minus, and that's along negative x direction. So, we can resolve this along the tangent and normal direction. So, VA minus, so let me draw this coordinate system again. So, we have x, y, then we have our normal direction, that's E sub n hat, this is E sub t hat, this angle is alpha, and VA minus is acting that way, right? So VA minus is a component along normal direction, that will be VA minus cosine alpha, and has a component along normal, has tangent direction, which will be VA minus sine alpha. So VA plus tangent direction is, VA minus tangent direction would be actually, so this is actually VA, let me write VA plus tangent is equal to VA minus tangent, and VA minus tangent is VA minus sine alpha, right? So that gives you the velocity of A after the impact in the tangential direction as VA minus sine alpha. So that's determined right away, okay, from this. And this is also determined, VB plus in the tangential direction is 0 because VB minus is 0, right? Okay, so now once we have VA plus tangent, VA VB plus tangent, we can substitute them in these two equations. So we can substitute them in here. In fact, we substitute in here, we don't get anything new, but this is what we need to use, right? So number two, so we need normal direction velocities after the impact. So where would we get that from? From the formula for coefficient of restitution, right? Which says that minus VB plus minus VA plus over VB minus minus VA minus. Now you will recall, we have discussed this, that these velocities have to be along normal direction because coefficient of restitution is defined as the ratio of linear impulse of force of restoration over force of deformation. And that means these velocities have to be along normal direction because the forces of deformation and restoration act along line of action or along the normal direction. So these should be all n's. Okay. Now VB minus n is 0 because the initial velocity of B is 0, right? And from this now, we can determine both VB plus, so let's call this equation, we'll call this 2 and 3. So from, so we'll call this equation 3. Okay, from now 2 and 3, we can determine both of these post-impact normal velocities, right? So you substitute all these numbers if they're given. This question, there's no number given, so you're just comparing the velocities from a previous problem, all right? Okay, so that's the scenario with the compliant pavement. Now, what happens for rigid pavement? So, rigid pavement, The analysis would proceed along a similar line. The difference would be actually in free body diagram, right? So, okay, let's draw a free body diagram again of the system. So we have B, we have A, that's your tangent direction, that's your normal direction. Okay, so for the system, what are the external forces acting on the system? So on the system, the only impulsive force is now going to be from the ground on the B. Okay, that will be acting in the upward direction, let's call it N. And this is an impulsive force. This is an impulsive force. All right. So what this is saying is that on the system, there is an external impulsive force acting, and that's acting along Y direction, vertical direction. Okay. So in the vertical direction, you can definitely not conserve linear momentum of the system, but you can conserve the linear momentum of the system along X direction. So what we can write is MA VA minus along X direction plus MB VB minus along X direction is equal to MA VA plus along X direction plus MB VB plus along X direction. Okay, now VB minus is zero, so this is set to zero, all right? What else can we say? Well, we know that B can really not go in the downward direction, right? It cannot really have a velocity in the Y direction, that much we know. So maybe we can just write that right away. So VB plus in the Y direction is going to be zero. Right, B is going to be constrained to move along the horizontal direction. That cannot have a component of velocity in the Y direction. Okay, so this is one equation we can write. This is the other one we can write. Now let's look at individual particles. So individual particles, let's look at B first. Tangent direction, normal direction. We have force of impulse from the truck. Let's call it, we'll call it R. And then we also have normal reaction from the ground on the B. Right? Okay, so let's look at these two forces. Can we conserve linear momentum of B in any direction? Let's look at X and Y first. So there is a component of R, right, along X direction, which will be R cosine alpha. So clearly we cannot conserve linear momentum along X direction. There is a force M in the Y direction, we cannot conserve momentum in the Y direction either. Let's look at the tangent normal direction. Tangent normal direction also we cannot conserve because there is a component of N along tangential direction, and R is of course acting along normal direction. So we cannot conserve linear momentum of particle B in any direction, right? So this alone might make for a very small, you know, good quiz problem where I might say, okay, these are the forces acting on particle B. Please tell me if there is a direction along which you can conserve linear momentum of B, right? Okay, so let's look at A. So here is our A, tangent direction, normal direction. The forces, we have the same reaction, right, which is an impulsive force, and there's no normal reaction on A from the ground because the tendency of this impact would be to lift the truck off the ground, right, which means that there will be no normal reaction on the truck. So what can you say about linear momentum of A? Okay, so this reaction force is acting along normal direction, so at least you can conserve linear momentum of A along tangential direction, right? So we can write this. So VA minus along tangential direction is VA plus along tangential direction. Now VA minus in the tangential direction we have already seen is actually VA minus sine alpha. So that gives us this as VA minus sine alpha, right? So, you know, we'll call this equation 3. Okay, so we are resetting the numbering over here for the case B. So VA plus in the tangential direction is known, VB plus along Y direction is known, and remember, you know, the velocities are along different direction, but you can resolve them along any coordinate system you want, right? Okay, so all these equations are obtained from looking at the free body diagram, an impact relevant free body diagram, which only shows impulsive forces, and then writing all these post-impact and pre-impact velocity relationships. So the only equation we have not used so far is the coefficient restitution, which says minus VB plus normal direction minus VA plus along normal direction over VB minus minus VA minus. And notice how all of these velocities are along normal direction. This is given to you as zero, okay? So all you have to do now is use these equations in case B to solve for all the post-impact velocities, okay?